And so with your eyes open and your gaze natural and focused or aimed down at the floor at about a 45-degree angle, be aware of the soles of your feet and the tops of your feet and your ankles. As I mention them, you can sort of feel how relaxed they feel. And your shins and your calves, the backs of your knees, the fronts of your knees, your thighs, the tops of your thighs, the inside of your thighs, the groin area, your buttocks, your belly. Take a deep breath and let your belly expand and then contract when you breathe out. Lower back, your upper back, feel your solar plexus area, your chest, relax your shoulders if you wish, feel your arms, your upper arms, lower arms, forearms, your hands where they rest on your thighs. And now the back of your neck and the front of your neck. Come in and have a seat, whoever it is. And the back of your head and the top of your head, which could feel like it's being sort of lifted up towards the ceiling a little bit. Everybody's got a nice straight back, that's good. And now your forehead, and relax your forehead. And your nose, your eyes and your cheeks. Just relax your face. Have a seat. And so now with your eyes open, and your gaze natural and down at the ground at about a 45-degree angle. You're not particularly swimmy with your focus and you're not bearing down. It's very relaxed, natural. And become aware of the breath as it exits your nostrils and goes out into the space. Your awareness is right here in the room. Aware of my voice and all the objects of sight that appear to you. Might be the floor, might have some awareness of the cushions in front of you, people in front of you. And your awareness is just resting right here in the room. And then the breath goes out into this room, like a line going out into the space, like a line drawn on water. It exits your nostrils, goes out, and then it dissolves into the space. It goes out, you can feel it as it exits your nostrils, goes out into the space, like a line, a highlight, and it dissolves, and we're just right here. And the breath goes out You can feel it as it exits your nostrils. It goes out like a line drawn on water, like an oar reaching out into the space of this room. And then it dissolves into this space. And we're all just right here. So the breath goes out, dissolves, and here you are. So we'll just do that for a few moments. So as you do this, thoughts will arise. And basically there are two kinds of thoughts, big ones and little ones. And the little ones are kind of like birds. They go across the sky of your mind. And you're still right here in the room with your breath. And it might go across and say, am I doing it right? And you let it go, and you just are aware of the breath going out. Or it might say, what's for dinner? And you see it, and you let it go. It evaporates all by itself, and you go out with the breath. And then big thoughts take you away. And at some point you realize that you have been lost in a dream of some kind. And without any self-criticism or heavy-handedness, you just observe the thought. That was your kind of thought, sort of who you are at that moment, and let it go and come back to the breath. And the breath goes out into the space. It dissolves. And then we're just right here in this room at this time, and the breath goes out, and it dissolves into the space, and here we are. So when thoughts take you away, as soon as you realize that you've been thinking, you come back. So let's just do that for a while. In this kind of meditation, there are no interruptions. If somebody walks into the room and startles you, it's actually a reminder, bringing you back into the present moment. Whatever happens, it's all part of the practice of awareness, of whatever is arising now. So any comments or questions about the practice? Take a little break and then go on. It's funny taking a break from it, huh? I mean, it's how do you take a break? Maybe you go to sleep. Solve a math problem. So we'll come back and just rest our minds in this present moment again, in the room, in this space. And then the breath goes out kind of like a line drawn on a piece of paper. And it dissolves. And then there's just a gap in your effort. The breath goes out, it dissolves, gap. Breath goes out, it dissolves into the space. You're right here, and then gap. So if you've been dreaming, come back. Be aware of the breath. You can feel it as it exits your nostrils. It goes out into the space like a line, dissolves, and then gap. And the breath goes out into the space of this room, like a line in the middle of the space, dissolves, and then gap. So you're aware of the breath going out into the space of this room. Like a line drawn on water, it dissolves into the space, and here you are. And the breath goes out, it dissolves into the space of the room, and here we all are. Have a bell, so we're not going to ring. Hi, Alan. You didn't hear me? Hi.
Could I ask a question?
Sure.
So when you're discussing the gap Could you maybe just talk a little bit more about that and explain, you know, how it relates to the end of the breath, end of the out breath?
Yeah, I mean, it's a gap in effort, a gap in self-consciousness, a letting go of that, for however long. So you can achieve it by simply becoming aware of the present moment, you know, that we're here in the room right now, and you have this open awareness of the space that encompasses whatever happens to arise. But sometimes there's a watcher watching you do that. You know, it's saying, you know, now I'm aware of the space. And so you could make an effort to let go of that. You can experiment with it. The watcher is very subtle, watching and commenting on what you're doing, you know. And it can also, when you're having a gap, you can sort of be watching yourself let go. But sooner or later, you know, you do. It's like you do let go. And you are right here in the space. And so that's really what it is. It's, you know, the breath going out. It's a highlight in the middle of like a line on water. And then it dissolves like a line on water. And then there's just this space of the room. It's open awareness. And the beauty of this practice, or one of the things I love about it, is, as someone said, is that there are no interruptions. You know, what we normally take to be an interruption when you're trying to concentrate on and achieve stillness is not an interruption in this, because this is awareness practice, mindfulness practice. And so if somebody walks into the room and, you know, jolts you, what they're really doing is bringing you back. You know, that's a reminder to come back, and which is a helper. So it's nice. There are no interruptions. Horn goes off on the street, whatever it might be. Your phone rings. Everything is part of it. So the gap is just an effort to let go of your self-consciousness. And sometimes it works to think of it that way, as a conscious effort of letting go, a gap. Sometimes it just works to be aware of the present moment, because when you're completely 100% aware, then there's no watcher, there's no commenter. The watcher is sort of like this extra person, like a hitchhiker. You know, he's sitting on your shoulder making comments. Now you're doing it, now you're not. That's a good one, that's a bad one. I wonder if I'm confused, you know, am I getting this? And he's making all these comments. That's the watcher. And the idea is that you don't need the watcher. You know, he's just a hitchhiker catching a ride. And you can let him go and just be here. Any other comments? So, the topic of this talk is the Buddha's fourth noble truth, which is the truth of the path. It's interesting, isn't it, that he ended with that. The first noble truth is the truth that we've got a problem. That's why we're all here, why we're all working on ourselves. We have something we would like to change, and it's the truth of suffering, one way or another. It's unhappiness, suffering. And the second noble truth is talking about how suffering arises and what causes it. And really, what that amounts to is a mistake that we make in believing from time to time, in thinking, literally thinking from time to time, that I exist and have some ongoing existence. And in fact, in a way, we sort of do. But really, what I is just a statement, a story about me, in which I am the hero. I is the hero, or the heroine. And we build up this whole story. And then as soon as we come present, and that voice inside us goes silent, well, there is no I. You know, I has gone silent. It's like you turned off the TV or the radio. And then the third noble truth is that there is an end to suffering. And the end of suffering really depends on the discovery that this world as it arises now is actually the real world. And the world of our thoughts is just a fiction, which is usefully true some of the time, but is actually pretty pernicious a lot of the time. And then the fourth noble truth, which is the topic tonight, is that there is a way to become free of suffering and more, to become a Buddha, because that's in fact what all of us actually fundamentally are. We've just lost track of it. We've gotten sidetracked into dreams. There's an old story about the Hindu trilogy of gods, you know, Brahma, Vishnu, Shiva. Brahma's the creator, Vishnu's the sustainer, and Shiva is the destroyer. And they're up in heaven, and Brahma decides he's going to go down to earth and sort of for kicks and grins, you know, just have a little adventure. And he goes down to earth, and he takes birth there as a pig. And he's rooting around and having a grand old time as a pig. And he forgets that he's Brahma. And he actually stays a pig, and he dies and he's reborn. He dies and he's reborn as a pig and a lot of times. And Vishnu and Shiva are up in heaven, and Vishnu's looking down, and he says, "We got to do something about this." And he says, "Shiva, could you go down and fix this?" And so Shiva goes down, and he finds Brahma the pig, and he takes out his sword and he slits open the pig's belly, and Brahma steps out and says, in effect, "Thanks, I needed that." And that's kind of a metaphor, you see, for all of us, that we've forgotten that we're fundamentally awake, and we've fallen asleep, we've fallen into dream, and the dreams are the dreams of me and mine, and they're fraught with anxiety and are driving forward towards the future, and are really, all these dreams are about the past and the future. We don't dream about the present. Who does that, you know, because we're already here, you don't need to. What we do is we dream about the past and the future. And there was a famous psychoanalyst, Fritz Perls, who invented Gestalt therapy, and he said that all thoughts about the past are actually thoughts about the future, because that's really our concern. When we think about the past, we're thinking about it in terms of how we can sculpt the future the way we want it and avoid the things about the past that we would rather not repeat. And so we live in this fog of anxiety and fear and hope about the future. And we're in the present, obviously. You know, we all can see what's in front of us. But there's this film of thought, of interpretation between us and the world. And it literally grays it out. I mean, when thought dissolves, the world can actually emerge much more brightly, especially vividly. The sense of vision is the most powerful of the five senses in Buddhist terms, and they call it the gateway to enlightenment. And it's one of the first things that one notices when you begin, for instance, to do a long meditation retreat, and your thoughts begin to thin out. Oftentimes people are surprised to see colors become much more bright. They don't expect it, because they haven't heard this somebody say what I'm saying. And they just notice that colors appear more brightly. Or perhaps some, you know, you had an experience where you were in some situation where suddenly your mind cleared for some reason, and suddenly you noticed the world as being very beautiful or warm or bright in some way. And in a moment, or in a, and it might go on for some period of time. And that's because the thought is clearing. I mean, when thought is really thick, when you're really wrapped up in some anxious dream, it really closes you off. And I'm sure everybody's experienced being lost in a dream and having somebody call your name and you didn't even hear it. They had to repeat it several times before you heard them because you were so consumed with some thought, probably an anxious one. So the path then is a path to awakening from dreams. And in fact, the word Buddha literally means the awakened one. Enlightenment, that term is a Western translation of, and it's not a very good one, it comes out of the 18th and 19th century, the idea of enlightenment, the Western idea of enlightenment, you know, as being sort of, you become very wise. But in the Indic languages, the word is Bodhi, and Bodhi simply means awakened. And Buddha is the awakened one. And awakened from what? Awakened from the dreams. The dreams of I and other. And all the complex forms that those dreams take. And they get very complicated indeed. And sophisticated and turn into great TV dramas and movies and novels. And fragments of them are playing usually in our head as we walk down the street all the time. And many people, until they start to meditate, don't even realize how much they're thinking. And even after you start to meditate, it's often amazing to notice that, oh my God, I've been thinking for the last however what period of time, you know, just lost in thought. So the basic practice of meditation, the basic core of meditation is coming back from dream to being awake in this present moment, just as we do in the morning when we wake up and we were having a dream and suddenly we realize, oh, I was dreaming and now I'm awake, back again. We do that. We can do that during the day. And that's the fundamental technique of the path, is that constant awakening. So we use the breath as kind of a way to pull us back into the present. The breath takes place nowhere but in the present. And so we use awareness of the breath as a way of sort of pulling us back out of dream to the present. Now, the fundamental problem that we're having and what we're working with on the path is the belief in I and other. It arises momentarily from time to time. It's not something that happened way back in history, although it did, but it's happening right now, you know, every second. And we can acknowledge it and let it go, just as we do when we're meditating and we realize that we're thinking. But it comes back again and again. It's a habit, an habitual pattern. They're called numduk in Tibetan, these habitual patterns. And they take different forms. But from this fundamental mistake, you might say, that I have a true existence, we think that I and others have some kind of ongoing being. But that's just an idea. Because what we actually experience is, you know, now I'm looking at Mike, and now I'm looking at, is it Ellery? Sorry? Huh? Lirio. How do you spell it? L-I-R-I-O. Lirio. Okay, that's an interesting name. So now I'm looking at Mike, now I'm looking at Lirio, now I'm looking at Rochelle. I mean, that's what we experience in the present moment. And I think, well, I'm looking at Rochelle, but Mike's still actually there, even though I'm not looking at him. And that's a thought. You know, that's a story. That's a concept. The problem is that we believe those things so powerfully that we build whole projections of our future and our past on them. And they entrap us into scripts, dramas that we create in our mind about me and my life and the peril of my life and the promise of my life. And it's like a TV drama, like we're on our own script writers. And this is what is really meant by the bonds of karma, that we're bound into the stories. And these stories take us into future lives. So we might decide, well, you know, I'm going to become a billionaire. And we set out to do that. And we start heading towards this fiction that we've created and trying to make it real. Of course, when it does become real, it's very different than we imagined it would be, because it is real and what we imagined wasn't. And it's always a little bit disappointing, isn't it, to get what you imagined. So the basic structure is the problem with suffering and where it originates is that it originates from this I-other error. And there's a whole description about how that arises that we're not going to go into tonight. And then out of that come what are called the defilements. And the defilements are the defiled relationships between I and other. Because as soon as we have an I-other relationship, you know, Mike's there and I'm here, then we start to have feelings about what is this relationship, you know. Is it a pleasant one? Is it an unpleasant one? Am I indifferent? Those are called the three poisons in Buddhism. Because if it's an unpleasant relationship with the other, you want to push it away. That's aggression. And if it's a pleasant one, you want to pull it towards you. That's passion. And if it's neutral, then you're indifferent to it. And that's, the word is moha in Sanskrit. And everybody has a hard time translating that. It's often translated as ignorance or stupidity. But I think indifference is probably the best translation, because we just sort of pass by. The thing is indifferent. But then things get really complicated and we put stories on it about, oh, that person slighted me, they've treated me very badly, and I'm going to get my revenge. And so we've got the emotion of revenge, or, you know, that person is so much richer than me and more talented and I wish I was like them. And then we have the emotion of envy. And it's always this I-other sort of a mixture. You take a little aggression and you mix it with a little passion, and you've got maybe jealousy, you know. You're jealous of somebody, and you put a storyline with it, you know, what you're jealous of that person for. I really like that person's partner, you know, I wish I could have a partner like that. I'm jealous. And it gets very complex, and these are called the defilements. And this is what we have to work with, is sort of the fundamental stuff of suffering. And there's a much more articulated description of this, because it's very helpful to understand the nuances of our predicament. When you begin to understand the nuances of it, then you don't get as seduced as readily. And there are all these descriptions of all the different forms that suffering, that ignorance, that this mistake takes. And so you can get seduced into being a god. A god is a person who has very little suffering, but still a little bit, because they're still making that fundamental I-other error. But they're getting a lot of pleasure. That's sort of the definition of what it means to be a god. Gods think that they have it made. And at the other end of the spectrum, you can wind up in hell and feel that you're existence is being threatened, and it's very painful, and there's threat and suffering and pain all around you, and there are people who are in hell. Occasionally we see them on the street, in a lot of different states in between. So the question is, how do we work with this? And the path is very articulated, and I'm sort of going fast here because I know that at least one person is new and doesn't know much of Buddhism, and I don't know you, so I can only project onto you, which I actually can't do. I have no idea. But he's got a Buddhist past. He has a Buddhist back? Pass?
Past life.
Oh, he is?
Yeah.
You know him?
Yeah.
Oh, you're friends? Oh, good, good.
Still to be
yeah. What's your name? Brendan. Yeah. Oh, okay, okay. Yeah, I've heard Mike speak of you. Nice to meet you.
Likewise.
Yeah. So the path is described in a number of ways. There are two main sort of structures for describing the path. One is called the five paths, and the other is the three yana structure. Three yana means vehicle. And they intersect, of course. You know, they you can line them up each with the other. I think I'll just talk about the five paths tonight and sort of go through that as a way of taking you along the journey. Is that doable? Yeah, I think so. You see, there are fundamentally two aspects to treading the path. One is that you're getting rid of error, you know, all the things that you're doing wrong, which means getting rid of suffering, too. But the other side of that is then what one discovers. And what one discovers is a very vivid world. So on the one hand, we're getting rid of the blinders, you know, like the filter. And on the other hand, then there's what we see when we take off the sunglasses. And the path, the Buddhist teachings describe both of these aspects because it's very helpful, and especially in the beginning, what the teachings are about in the first part of the path are about removing the blinders, getting rid of the error, you know, fixing the mistake, which has to do with getting rid of suffering. And then the latter stages of the path are about what we discover. The world, the true world, the real world. You see, it's very useful to describe that even from the beginning because it pulls us along. It pulls us out of our error. We begin to recognize what it is to be sane and the description of the world of sanity and how it what it looks like. And that pulls us, it magnetizes us along. So it's very important to have what in Buddhism they call the view. And the view is the view forward towards the world, the real world, the world of reality. The first part of the path, I'm going to do both, the Hinayana part of the path, since I know Brendan knows all this and everybody else does too. And this is the sort of the first stages of the path, the first yana of the three, is really about curing suffering and about curing also that most fundamental of all errors, the belief in an ego. I mean, it's extraordinary, isn't it, that we're mired in, if you can, you see, most of us sit here and we say, yeah, but I really do believe in me. And but once you begin to get a taste of it, that it's not true, then it begins to become slightly incredible that we were stuck in this for so long, this falsehood, you know. You begin to get a feeling for that. But in the beginning, it feels like, you know, I don't know if I buy that, that I don't exist, that I doesn't exist. See, what I really is just a fiction, just like the story of Mickey Mouse, or just like the latest movie drama, Loving, that you saw. I mean, it's based on real stuff, you know, because there are people moving around, but the story is fictional, and it's about a fictional character. And in fact, when the movie ends, that character dissolves, right? Just as when our lives end, we dissolve, you know, just the movie's over. And it's the same thing. So really the first part of the path, and this is the first of the two of the five paths, is about overcoming or beginning to see that I is a fiction that we don't have to believe in. I once, when I first heard this idea from my teacher, who was a man named Trungpa Rinpoche, way back in 1970, and I was sitting in front of him at Tale of the Tiger, now Karmé Choling, on the floor, and he was sitting in a chair, and during the Q&A, I said to him, well, you know, doesn't I kind of exist in some provisional way? You know, we sort of need it in order to function. And he had a microphone in front of him like this one. And he leaned forward and he bellowed into the mic, "Ego is a lie!" Like that. And I thought what he was saying is that it's like saying, you know, it's a lie to say that somebody did something they didn't do, you know, that way. But he didn't mean that way. He meant that literally the statement, "I am," is a lie. It's a lie. And a pernicious one, because it breeds so much suffering. The kleshas that come out of it, the defilements. So that's really the first part of the path, is we're working with that, and we do that as we do all along the path, by developing three aspects. What is called our meditation practice, I'm just going to translate it, samadhi, prajna, and sila in Sanskrit. Samadhi means our meditation practice. Prajna is our intelligence, which means our ability to see the world clearly, even in just moments, stripped of preconception, stripped of our judgments, stripped of our labels of I and other, good and bad, all of that. And we just open our minds and in the first moment see the world nakedly. And we are beginning to develop prajna. And ironically, this is called wisdom. Prajna literally means sort of, pra is an intensifier, means kind of like super. And jnana is to know. So it's kind of super knowledge or transcendent knowledge. And it's transcendent because it has nothing to do with I and other. It's just seeing the world stripped, naked. And then the third aspect, Shila, is discipline. And on the lowest level, that means that you observe rules of good conduct. You don't kill, you don't steal, you don't lie, you don't you don't have improper sex, whatever that is anymore. And you don't drink alcoholic beverages is one of them if you're really observing, you know, some of them. And then there are other things like, you know, you don't cheat and all kinds of things. There are hundreds of rules of conduct. But on a more subtle level, really what it means is that one acts in consonance with an appreciation for this world as it rises in the present moment. This is also part of the first level of the path, the Hinayana, and of the first two, five paths. It's called developing a healthy mind, a kusala chitta. Kusala means healthy, chitta means mind. And what a healthy mind is a mind that appreciates the beauty of this world as it arises in the present moment. The vividness of it, the life, the love that it carries, and that it's worth being here for no reason at all, just fundamentally worth being here for. And we are beginning to approach this idea of Buddha nature, in with that idea of healthy mind. The second yana, which is called the Mahayana, and which corresponds, the entrance to the Mahayana corresponds to the third path. The third path is called the path of vision. The first two paths are called the path of accumulation and the path of preparation. And what you're accumulating, you see, is what you're preparing is you're preparing by studying all these ideas, like we're doing tonight. You're preparing by meditating, because you're beginning to see how crazy your mind is, your monkey mind, and you're also beginning to see the clarity of mind, right? And you are contemplating, you know, the whole thing, and you're beginning to bring it in. And in doing that, you begin to develop this appreciation for the world. And the entrance then into the second yana, and also the third path. The third path is called the path of vision. And what it means is that at some point you've prepared and it's just been ideas so far, you know, the idea of egolessness, the idea of prajna and so forth. But at some point, you actually see it. You see reality. The mind clears enough that it becomes really powerfully vivid, like a shock, maybe. People experience it variously. There are people who experience it very naturally without ever hearing the Buddhist teachings. There's a gap in their neurosis and their confusion. And that is the entrance into the Mahayana. It's for those of you who know the structure of the Mahayana with the 10 bhumis, it's the first bhumi, which is called great joy, because the practitioner has seen the truth of egolessness, that it's actually true that this world is not a world of things, of sort of static entities. It's a continual arising and passing away in the present moment. Everything is being born and dying instantaneously all the time. And as everything is born and dies, it communicates what it is so vividly and powerfully to us and meaningfully. And we can participate in that. And the participation that we could give it, our open-heartedness, our open-mindedness, our open-bodiness, is compassion. That's the compassion of the Mahayana. And so the Bodhisattva then, or the entrant, the person who's entering the Mahayana, has this experience of this vision, which might be momentary. It might go on for some period of time. Might go on forever. There are people who have that moment, and they're instantly enlightened. They're called instant realizers, and they're few and far between. But there are those people. But for most of us, it's just a glimpse, and that we've had in the past, and we remember. And when you remember it, it closes down again. You say, "Ooh, I had an experience," you know? And as soon as you do that, well, you're not doing it anymore. I'm back. The aggrandizer, you know, the self-promoter is back. And so it's closed down, that experience of emptiness. And so what the path then becomes, and that's the fourth path, and it's really the whole progress through the Mahayana, is to constantly come back to that moment of openness, awareness, as best you can. And that becomes the process of meditation. Meditation is no longer a mental exercise. It's really even more a process of coming back to the real, what's our fundamental nature. And as one does that, the thing of the watcher gets thinner and thinner and thinner through the Mahayana. And finally, there's enlightenment itself. And enlightenment means the fundamental discovery that I and other were complete fictions. And not only that, but that this world, as it arises right now, is beautiful, meaningful, vivid, in all of its pain and pleasure, life and death, you know, the ugliness and the beauty of it, is all worth being here for. And this is the world of the third jhana, the Vajrayana. And it's also the fifth path, which is called the path of no more learning. Because then the person is just here participating, playing with the world, dancing. It's called play, ropa. They often picture yogis juggling the sun and moon because that's all they've got to do in life anymore. that's a quick overview of the Buddhist path from the Tibetan Vajrayana perspective. There's so much. I mean, this is like such a gloss. There's so much to be said. Goes books and books and libraries on the detail of what's contained within that fundamental structure. So we could have a discussion about this path that we're kind of drawn to. You know, they say that all sentient beings, all, will achieve enlightenment. Now, there were schools that said that you can get stuck at the Hinayana level and just become a Pratyeka Buddha, as a self-enlightened Buddha. And, you discover egolessness and you achieve freedom from suffering, permanent. But other schools, and really the ones we adhere to, say that when a person achieves that, sooner or later, the Buddhas will come to him or her and say, time to move along, and awaken them into the Mahayana, the greater vehicle. Because what the Mahayana is really about, you see, above all, is about being of service to other sentient beings. There's a quote, there's a great text by a great Buddhist. He was, I think he was 7th century AD, Shantideva, the Bodhicharyavatara. And I just wrote it here. It says, I think I've got it down here. Let me see. For as long, this is the vow that a person who is entering the Mahayana takes, because you see, now they're inspired to help others. They are developing bodhicitta. Bodhicitta is the mind of awake. Bodhi, awake, citta, mind. And the mind of awake has fundamentally two aspects. One is it's fundamentally awake, and the other is the desire to awaken all other sentient beings. And it has an inferior, a middle, and a superior grade. And the inferior is not so inferior. It's not a slim, you know. Inferior is pretty darn good. Maitreya, the Buddha of the future, achieved the inferior, the so-called inferior grade, the lower grade. The inferior grade says, I'm going to get enlightened so that then I can help all of everybody else get enlightened. The middle grade says, I am going to get enlightened simultaneously with all other sentient beings. And by sentient beings, we mean microbes, right down to that level, anything that's alive. And then the superior grade says, I'm going to get enlightened, and I'm going to put off my enlightenment until I've helped all other sentient beings achieve enlightenment. And that person stays at the level of the 10th bhumi, and the last stage of the bodhisattva path, until all others are enlightened. And here's this famous quote from Shantideva. It's so beautiful. He says, just four lines, for as long as space endures and for as long as living beings remain, until then may I too abide to dispel the misery of the world. Just so beautiful. Yes.
I think, you know, in the context of what's going on right now with, like, the election, I think we're seeing, you know, a lot of people, there's a lot of anxiety, a lot of suffering on both sides of the political, you know, spectrum. And, you know, can you maybe talk a little bit about how we can, you know, I feel like there's two aspects. One is how we work with our own anxieties and the stories that we're telling ourselves, and how that creates that anxiety, you know, in relation to, you know, the election and what's going on. And it doesn't have to be specific about that. Obviously, it works for all kinds of anxieties that we have, but I think a lot of people are experiencing a lot of anxiety. And then also how maybe, you know, the Bodhisattva path or the Shantideva's quote, for example, like how you can go beyond that, beyond just sort of working with your own fears and anxieties to working, you know, with the fears and anxieties that are constantly, you know, being expressed right now, you know, by, in a way, almost like reaching across the aisle, right, in a political sense, and how to do that maybe from a Buddhist perspective that might be more pragmatic or effective than just arguing facts back and forth.
Right. I think, you know, a situation like the one we're in is a huge challenge for us to maintain our clarity of mind and our compassion for all sentient beings. Now, compassion doesn't mean that There's a difference between compassion and idiot compassion. Yeah, that's what they call it in the teachings. Or grandmother's love, it's called. And we're not going to be guilty of that. But at the same time, for instance, there are things that are proscribed for Hinayana practitioners. So for instance, you don't lie, you know? But for the Mahayana practitioner who begins to have more insight, lying might be a useful tool to help other people in some instances, you know? And in fact, there's a phrase that Trungpa Rinpoche used once. I heard him use it, and I later discovered it wasn't his. He was telling me I was going into a difficult situation on his behalf, and he told me not to be naive in this. And he said, sometimes you have to use the body of truth with the tentacles of lies. And meaning, you know, you use lies to further the greater truth, you know, the small, like white lies or whatever. And I later found that same phrase. I thought it was his, but later I was studying a text by the ninth Karmapa, Wangchuk Dorje, famous. He was a famous lama, and it was right there in the text. It was from the 1600s somewhere. So the thing is, I think that what we need to be doing in this is looking for what is really harmful in the environment and in our world, and addressing ourselves to that, but not to become caught up in the aggression ourselves as much as possible. I mean, you know, I'm sure you've all experienced it. When I was the only person in this room, Alan might be old enough, you know, the Vietnam War, and I was part of the political movement. Were you a kid during the Vietnam War? No, I mean, but how old are you?
Old enough to remember.
Old enough. Well, everybody's old enough to remember. But the question is, were you there? I mean, like Jim Lowry started that book of his on, you know, Taming Untamable Beings, and he said of the 60s, if you can remember the 60s, you weren't there. But I was there, and I was part of the Vietnam movement, and it was full of aggression. I mean, you know, the people fighting the war were so aggressive, and they treated their opponents as though they were monsters, you know? And I remember walking into the bathroom at the University of Chicago and seeing scrawled over the walls, you know, with big magic marker, up against the wall, fascist pigs, you know, like that. And there was so much rhetoric like that, and it isn't useful, it isn't sane. It's one thing to fix a situation. It's another thing to become involved in the aggression of it and become aggressive yourself. And this is really the challenge for us, I think, in this post-election time, how to act sanely for the good of people in this country with compassion and understanding, and not to get caught up in fear and aggression ourselves. And then we become part of the problem, really, and no different than the people we're attacking, you know, in some way. Alan?
There was a famous photograph.
Thank you.
There's a famous photograph from those days of a line of National Guardsmen with their rifles and confronting a group of, I guess they were called flower children at the time. And there was a photograph of a woman placing a flower in the what of the rifle?
Yeah, the barrel.
Of the rifle. And sometime later, quite a bit later, someone got located the guardsman who was holding the rifle and asked what that was like for him. And he said, I'll never forget the hate in her eyes. Yeah. So that's an example of how to make things worse. And I think, you know, I see this on Facebook. You know, there are people who are hell-bent on heaping contempt on people who voted the other way.
Right.
And then there are people who are saying, come on, they're human beings too. We have to learn how to talk to each other. And it seems very difficult to reconcile those two approaches right now. Maybe in the course of time, things will soften up a bit. But right now, there's just so much rage that I think a lot of people find it difficult to get past that. It's probably just the stage of grieving, in a way, you could say.
Yeah. Especially when we're confronted with aggression, you know, coming towards us or coming towards people we care about. How do we deal with that? You know, we have to deal with that in a way that's sane and effective, but try not to get caught up in counter-aggression ourselves, because then we become like the aggressors in our own turn. And it's also ineffective, just polarizes the situation to a greater degree, I think. Although that's a question. Sometimes violence is necessary. You know, the Buddha, in his enlightenment, exercised what are called the four karmas, the four actions. Karma literally means action. And confronted with a difficult or a neurotic situation, you might say, that needed curing, the first thing one does is one pacifies. That's the first karma. And the way you pacify is through spreading understanding. Understanding of a situation can pacify it. You know, if you can understand why someone voted, you know, again in a way that you didn't vote, and what drove them and what lit them, you know, it might mitigate your anger about it. So I saw a guy being interviewed on TV who worked for Carrier, lived in Michigan, about 45, has a family, and he said he voted for Obama in the last election. Guy was white. And because Obama promised change, and Obama didn't deliver. And that's true, I think. And he, whether it is, it doesn't matter. And he said, and now he said Carrier is going to move their plant to Mexico. And he's been making $29 an hour. What's that, about 60 grand a year? And he's looking at the possibility that he might have to go to work for Kmart or Walmart and make 15 bucks an hour instead of 29. And what's he going to do? So Trump gets up and he promises that if Carrier moves to Mexico, he's going to slap him with a 35% tariff when they bring their air conditioners back in the United States. So the guy votes for Trump. So I think it's possible, you know, the first karma is the karma of bringing understanding. And when you do that, it can pacify a situation. And then the second karma is the karma of generosity, of enrichment, that you give to a situation. You give largesse, you give whatever you've got, you know, to a situation. You can pacify it that way. And the third is seduction, that, you know, you might magnetize a situation and seduce it, seduce people into your point of view or your understanding. And then if none of those work, the last resort is destruction. That's the fourth karma. And that can be, if that's employed in a way that's meant to be of benefit to the people who are involved, then it's enlightened. It can be enlightened. But if it's just meant to get rid of your opponents, well, not so good. Huh? Yeah, I can give you the one that Trungpa Rinpoche gave. When, way back in 1970 or 71, somebody asked him the same question. And he said, Christ throwing the money changers out of the temple. Yeah.
He also said that if he had an opportunity to be in the same room with Hitler, he would have killed him.
Yeah. Did he say that?
Yeah.
Yeah. Hey, we're gonna get, sure. That makes complete sense, doesn't it?
Could you see the Civil War as another example? Ending slavery?
Yeah, Mike.
Yeah, I just said, could you see something like the Civil War as another example of that which ultimately ended slavery?
Yeah, I think it's a muddier example because there are other things involved, but certainly that's the main driver, I guess.
Yeah, it's been very tough. I mean, obviously not just for me, but to every day maintain a sitting practice, which I've been doing, but then to try to show up for this world as it is and without contributing to the aggression out there, still feel the sense of urgency. And maybe it's, you know, me wielding my own storylines, my own fears about the future, like you were saying, yet there's this sense, this impending sense that there's a window of opportunity to act now. And I feel like we live in a bubble in the city. So it's hard to reconcile that. And then I think about your story about this, you know, I forget which master it is, but kind of juggling the sun and the moon.
Yeah.
And I imagine, like, you know, the worst case scenario, fascism takes over, there's concentration camps again. I'm in one, you know, can I juggle the sun and the moon in a cell?
Yeah.
And that's, you know, that's me voicing my deepest fears, I guess.
Sure. Sure. And there's a guy named Fleet Mall, Dharma brother of mine, years back, who went to jail for 18 years for being a kingpin, drug kingpin. He actually took the fall for a bunch of other people too. But he was selling drugs, and
Because it relates to the four actions. He asked Rinpoche what I should do, and he said, you should go to jail.
Rinpoche told him that?
Yes. Yeah. So that's kind of a destroying.
The destroying one,
karma.
Right?
Yeah.
Right.
You just need to just, you know, before go
that,
to a, what?
Before that, Rinpoche told him to stop selling drugs.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. He was selling them pretty big time, too. He had a boat and everything. Running drugs up and down the coast, but he and in jail he taught the Dharma for 18 years, and he wrote a book called The Dharma in Hell, and he created a program to bring Buddhist teachings back into prisons. He's done a lot of that work since he got out, and he's now a teacher in the Shambhala Buddhist Sangha, and you know, as a life, but he survived 18 years in jail as a Buddhist and in teaching meditation and doing his own practice. And
he became a monk.
Did he become a monk in jail?
I used to correspond with
him. Really?
Sorry.
He finished Nundro in jail, in prison. And he became a monk. I think, if I'm not mistaken, Trungpa Rinpoche came to the prison and gave him monastic vows.
Gave him what?
Monastic vows.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
That's interesting. So, I mean, the thing is, you know, I mean, ultimately, we're all going to die. And there are going to be bad things that happen to us along the way. All kinds of loss. Ultimately, we lose our whole body. And that's not pretty. And how do we, you know, relate to all of that? And what the Buddhist teachings are saying is it's all worth being here for and dealing with and relating to, and that it can be done creatively. And if we react with fear and aggression, we're really just trying to get out. You know, we're trying to avoid it. We're looking for a bolt hole, you know, and there is none. There really is none. So the challenge for us is how to come present and deal in a way that has intelligence, heart, and creativity in it, even when it's ugly, even if it's a concentration camp, even if we're dying. And we will be dying. It's really interesting, isn't it, getting old? I've had my hip replaced. my left shoulder replaced, and I've learned in the last couple of weeks I'm probably going to have my right shoulder replaced. I'm turning into metal man. And that's just the beginning. I mean, I'm just watching my body fall apart. It's really interesting, and it happens to everyone if you live long enough.
It starts to happen when you're in your 20s.
And younger,
You get to your prime, and then it starts to fall apart.
I didn't realize this one. I'm entering a program in social work at NYU. And I went to an introduction for new students, and I listened to them describe some of the field placements that are available. One of them, talk about charnel ground, is being a hospice worker, a pediatric hospice worker. I mean, the euphemism or the complexity of that term in itself is horrifying, isn't it? They're not saying helping dying children. They're saying being a pediatric hospice worker. Wow. I mean, want to deal with that? I mean, suffering? Yeah, that's heartbreaking, isn't it? The idea.
When I was 11, I spent 2 months in the hospital because I was really sick. And I was supposed to rest in bed. Anyway, I was in a ward. It was after 3 weeks, the insurance ran out, so then I had to be in a ward. And it was, it was a long time ago. And the ward, it was this huge, huge room, and every bed had a curtain that went, you could close. And at night, most of the people there, there was a young girl that was with me. She was 15, I was 11, next to me in my bed. And then everyone else was very old. And at night, these women would be crying because they needed help. So I would get out of bed, and I would go around and, help everyone, whatever they needed. But that was my... Then when all the curtains would close suddenly, you knew that there was a dead body being wheeled out. And once I went to the... out in the corridor to make a phone call, and there was a foot with a tag on it. That was my introduction to the charnel ground.
For those of you who don't know what a charnel ground is, in India, the best way to treat a body is you cremate it. And if you're a Hindu, you have ashes scattered in the Ganges. That's a very holy thing. And but if you don't have enough money, then your body just might be dumped in a charnel ground for animals to eat. That's what it's called. They call that dumping ground a charnel ground.
Yeah, and Trungpa Rinpoche used to say, because in Tibet, also they would throw bodies, they'd hack bodies up, throw them in the charnel ground, and then the vultures would come and eat them. So that was considered to be a good practice.
A sky burial,
exactly. And then the yogis would come and do practices there to practice on impermanence. Anyway, and then he told us that in Tibet, that was the charnel ground. But in America, the charnel grounds were the hospitals where they'd put all the sick and dying, just get rid of them, and nobody ever wanted to relate to the charnel ground because you throw someone in a hospital and then you don't want to deal with it anymore because it's ugly, and nobody wants to see anything that's ugly. So when he started talking about that, I realized that I had experienced the charnel ground when I was 11 years old. And that's where I really started to develop, a great compassion for the suffering of others. It was an interesting situation. And every time whenever I went to a hospital, I always thought of Rinpoche and the charnel ground.
There's been a vast evolution in hospitals too. I mean, if you read Atul Gawande, the Indian author who writes about death and dying a lot. He's a surgeon terrific writer. Oh my gosh. I just read one of his books called Being Mortal. I recommend it highly. But he points out that really prior to the Second World War, hospitals were very different than they are today. Today, they're a place you can go to get cured. Prior to the Second World War, they were really holding bins for the ill and dying. And the thing that changed everything was the invention of penicillin in around late 1930s, early 40s. And now hospitals are places you can go to get cured, but as well as to die. But back then they were very different in the first part of the 20th century. Yes.
I'd like to respond to something you said, Mike, because you described something that I'm pretty sure we all go through, that is to kind of create a scenario of disaster. Like, you know, at a certain point, it's going to really be unbelievably bad. And, you know, for me, the practice is to cut it out, you know, to not do that. Because that's the only way I can avoid working myself up into a state of anxiety and fear. And ultimately, some kind of paralysis, you know. So the worst may or may not happen. But with practice, I feel that it will become more likely that whatever does happen, you spoke about, you know, clarity and being able to see clearly. Whatever does happen, hopefully I'll be able to see clearly what is happening and even perhaps knowing how to respond to what is happening. But I think, you know, projections of disaster are definitely not the way to go, if we can manage it. Not easy.
I find personally, I don't know about you guys, that I'm most vulnerable to those kinds of fears of disaster in the morning, when I awaken from dream and I'm lying in bed. And it's become a discipline for me. It's very difficult for me to make myself get out of bed quickly rather than lie there, because the longer I lie there, the more I roll around in those negative thoughts, those, you know, disastrous scenarios. And as soon as I get out and my feet hit the floor, the vividness of the phenomenal world, the sensual world, the coolness of the floor on my feet, you know, the feeling of the toothbrush in my mouth, you know, urinating into the toilet, all those things, it's like the fog of those thoughts goes away to some extent, a greater or lesser extent. And it's a huge lesson. Because this is what meditation is, you know. It's coming back from the fog of those thoughts. And those thoughts can be terrible, you know. They can be pleasant, but it's kind of like, I think of it as like, he who lives by the sword dies by the sword, you know. If you put your faith in the good thoughts, you're going to get screwed by the bad ones. And I know what you're talking about, Alan. It's just, they can be devastating, those thoughts. Thoughts of, and in fact, they lead one into crimes towards others, and crimes towards oneself. I think that those thoughts can ultimately lead one into suicide, which is the, from any religious perspective, including Buddhist, the ultimate crime. I heard Trungpa Rinpoche once. He said the reason that, you know, suicide is such a heinous crime. He said, if you kill another person, you just kill one person. But when you kill yourself, you're killing the whole world. You're rejecting it. Saying, I don't want to be here for this. So that's one way of looking at it. Yeah, they're powerful, those negative thoughts. So what we need to do is practice the path. Prajna and compassion. I mean, they're the drivers of the path. Prajna is clear seeing. Compassion is opening your heart to others of all kinds. Everybody, not just the club, my club, but of that guy who works for Carrier in the Midwest. And I mean, don't we all have friends who voted differently than we and we can't understand it? And anybody here not have a friend like that? Oh, I've got two friends who just shocked me, you know, telling me that, you know, their vote, and I'm sure there are more. I sort of don't want to know. Yeah. So we should end. Next week, Michael Rogan is going to give a talk. This is a wonderful guy. He is a neuroscientist who specialized in working with people, you know, and doing research on people with PTSD, post-traumatic stress disorder, and anxiety disorders. And then he decided he actually wanted to help those people, so he went and took an MSW, same one I'm going to be in, and he now treats those people, and he is a devoted, longtime student of Khandra Rinpoche, wonderful Buddhist teacher. If you don't know her, and one of the only one who's a woman that I know of, female Tibetan Rinpoche, and she is terrific. And he's a longtime student of hers, and she's encouraged him now to start teaching here in New York. And he's teaching about his work about bringing meditation to the people whom he treats. And this first talk was terrific. So he's going to be here next week. I'm really looking forward to it. And a couple of other announcements. The Westchester Buddhist Center is having its annual retreat. If you ever feel like you want to do a week of sitting meditation, semi-silent. Part of it will be silent, and there'll be times when that's relaxed. And it's going to be at the Garrison Institute, February 3rd through 10th, I think, are the dates. And you can find out more about it at the Westchester Buddhist Center website. And we're having some interesting events up there. I'm part of this group. Sharon Salzberg is coming to speak December 5th, I think, somewhere around in there. And I can't remember if we have any other speakers scheduled. But, yes?
About the retreat, I believe you could also attend just for a weekend.
Yeah, you can come just for a weekend, right? You can do that. So let's end with the dedication of merit. We don't have the chance, but so if you don't know it, you can just listen. This is in the spirit of helping all sentient beings to achieve enlightenment. We give away any merit that has been accomplished tonight to them.
By this merit, may all attain omniscience. May it defeat the enemy wrongdoing from the stormy waves of birth, old age, sickness, and death, from the ocean of samsara. May I free all beings by the confidence of the golden sun of the great east. May the lotus garden of the Rigdon's wisdom bloom. May the dark ignorance of sentient beings be dispelled. May all beings enjoy profound, brilliant glory.
Thank you all. That was really terrific conversation. Wonderful.